В этой связи считаю необходимым принять уже давно назревшее решение. Незамедлительно признать независимость и суверенитет Донецкой Народной Республики и Луганской Народной Республики. Прошу Федеральное собрание Российской Федерации поддержать это решение, а затем и ратифицировать договоры о дружбе и взаимопомощи с обеими республиками. В соответствии со статьей 51 части 7 Устава ООН, санкции Совета Федерации России и во исполнение ратифицированных Федеральным собранием 22 февраля сего года договоров о дружбе и взаимопомощи с Донецкой Народной Республикой и Луганской Народной Республикой, мною принято решение о проведении специальной военной операции.
On February 24, 2022, the largest military operation in Europe since the end of World War II was launched. Russian tanks, infantry, artillery and planes entered sovereign Ukrainian territory, following the recognition of two breakaway rebel republics in the east. As of writing this script, 20 days have passed since Russian troops crossed the border, and unknown thousands of lives have been lost, both military and civilians. A new refugee crisis is emerging in the European Union, as millions of Ukrainians flee their homes to escape the suffering. Vladimir Putin's goals are of yet a mystery. Perhaps he wishes to annex huge swathes of territory from Ukraine. Perhaps he wishes simply to annex those rebel republics in the Donbass. Perhaps he wishes to dismantle the functioning democracy on his doorstep. Whatever his intentions, he currently stands as the greatest existential threat to a democratic Ukraine. When the war began, it appeared to come out of nowhere. After months of military posturing on the border, very few truly believed a full-scale invasion would become a reality. But when looking through the past, it's easy to see how this was inevitable. For decades, Russia's elite under Vladimir Putin have been carefully undertaking the delicate process of preparing the Russian people for war. We were simply too blind to see. Ukraine is not Russia. Putin seems to have a hard time understanding this. Ukraine possesses a culture, language, and values distinct from their Russian neighbor. Since Ukraine gained independence in 1991, these facts have always troubled the Russian elite. Russian foreign policy is defined primarily by one objective: expand west. Due to the indefensible terrain of its western border, Russia has always sought to create as much distance between Moscow and its enemies as possible. Until the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991, Russia had been incredibly successful in this goal, but when this distance suddenly came under the control of newly independent nations, many of whom sought alignment with the West, Moscow was suddenly less than 500 kilometers from its border. The vulnerability of Moscow since the collapse of the Soviet Union is one of the primary reasons for its hostility towards Ukraine today, which lies only 490 kilometers away. But Putin's desire to control Ukraine is not solely geopolitical. Ideology also plays a substantial role. The Soviet Union's collapse saw the rise of a nationalistic elite in Moscow, including Putin himself. Many in charge of Russia's state apparatus espouse views from famous Russian nationalists like Ivan Aksakov, Mikhail Katkov, and Yuri Samarin. These ideals preach that Ukrainian identity is inseparable from Russian identity, that the Ukrainian language is an artificial creation, and that Ukrainian culture is indistinct from Russian, referring to Ukrainians on occasion as Maloruski, Little Russians. Although these beliefs were likely formed to justify the subjugation of those occupying Russia's most vulnerable lands, most Russian nationalists, including Putin himself, seem to genuinely believe this. Because of these views, Ukraine occupies a unique place in the Russian psyche compared to other former Soviet states. Lithuania was believed to be subservient to Moscow, but Russians recognized its unique culture and identity. Kazakhstan had an inferior culture in the minds of Russian nationalists, but still possessed a culture nonetheless. Ukraine, on the other hand, is Russia. and the Russian establishment is thus unprepared to respect its sovereignty, believing its current state to be a Western invention designed to cripple Russia. However, these nationalistic views were not held by the majority of Russians until very recently. The cultivation of these views in Russian society has been a careful process undertaken over the last 22 years since Vladimir Putin's rise to power, preparing the population ultimately for conflict. The spread of hostility towards Ukraine and Russia began under Putin, who himself is an ultranationalist. Over his reign, Ukrainian identity in the eyes of the Russian people was slowly degraded, reaffirmed by the new Russian elite in order to weaken the idea of Ukrainian sovereignty. In 2008, Vladimir Putin, in a private conversation with George Bush, attacked the idea of Ukraine. Ukraine is not even a state. What is Ukraine? A considerable part of its territory is in Eastern Europe, but another part, a considerable one, was a gift from us, referring to Khrushchev's ceding of Crimea to the Ukrainian SSR as a gift. In 2016, Prime Minister Dmitry Medvedev commented on Ukrainian sovereignty, saying Ukraine has neither industry nor state. And in 2020, Kremlin spokesperson and former close advisor to Putin, Vladislav Surkov, said, "There is no Ukraine. There is Ukrainianism, that is a specific mental disorder, but there is no Ukraine." These are just a few examples of anti-Ukrainian sentiment in Russia. Comments like these from the elite have had one effect: the creation of a countrywide rhetoric that Ukraine is not distinct enough to deserve sovereignty or self-determination. Alongside this rhetoric is the sense of victimhood, bolstered through propaganda outlets like Russia Today. Russian foreign policy believes that Russia exists wherever Russians exist, a view which has justified the invasion of Georgia in 2008, as well as control over Central Asia, and is now being used to justify the invasion of Ukraine. 29% of Ukraine's population is Russian-speaking, concentrated almost solely in the east. The Kremlin thus regards these people as part of Russia, victims of an anti-Russian regime. Propaganda has been crucial in the spread of this idea, spreading false stories of violent oppression against these Russian speakers, using a tactic dubbed by Christopher Paul and Miriam Matthews as a fire hose of falsehood. The goal of Russian media propaganda is to lie, entertain, and overwhelm the audience. An abundance of information will be parroted across the many thousands of Russian propaganda outlets, 99% of it being false. This tactic is based on the psychological principle of first impressions. When people are presented with a piece of information, they are most likely to accept it if it's their first time seeing it, and will favor that first piece of information over any contradictory messages. By showing thousands of fake stories about violence against Russian speakers in Ukraine across thousands of different propaganda outlets, the audience will believe it to be true, no matter what contradictory evidence is presented. This tactic has been used against Ukraine for decades. False stories of atrocities against Russians have been knowingly spread by Kremlin-backed mouthpieces. For example, a debunked story circulated that ISIS fighters had joined pro-Ukrainian forces during the 2014 crisis. Many stories claimed to have evidence that the Ukrainian government was carrying out a non-existent genocide of Russian speakers, and a sensationalist story spread that pro-Ukrainian forces had crucified a young Russian child. All these stories were false, known by propagandists to be false, and spread regardless. Prior to the Euromaidan revolution of 2014, which saw the ousting of the pro-Russian president Viktor Yanukovych, propaganda seemed to spread information preparing Russians for Ukraine's reintegration into its sphere of influence. However, once the post-Maidan democratic regime came to power, propaganda shifted, seemingly preparing Russians for war. After 8 years of turmoil in a democratic Ukraine, Putin's regime finally launched its all-out invasion, ending over 75 years of peace in Europe, attempting to bring Ukraine back under its sphere of influence. After decades of preparing the Russian people, how well did these tactics work? On the news, you may be familiar with the widespread anti-war protests in Russia. Thousands of people across the entire country have risked their lives to protest Putin's corrupt, autocratic regime in their decision to invade a sovereign state, and thousands have been subsequently arrested. In the media, an image of widespread Russian disapproval of the war has been painted. But how accurate is that? The answer is not at all. Thousands of protesters have taken to the streets and have been arrested, but in the largest country on earth, thousands is a minority. Polls conducted by independent researchers have discovered that the propagandists have been successful, with 58% of the Russian population approving of the war, and an even higher number approving of Putin. The rhetoric espoused over the years by Putin's cronies and paid propagandists have worked. Through repetition, informational bombardment, and the spread of misinformation, an entire population has been conditioned to support a war of aggression in which a dictatorship is attempting to destroy a democracy. What Putin's regime has taught us is that anyone is susceptible to propaganda. We are all easily conditioned to believe whatever those above us want us to believe, without knowing that someone is responsible for making us think the way we think. And the consequences of that? Well, they speak for themselves.
Єбать, дивіться ж!
Evacuation convoy has managed to leave the key port of Mariupol in the south of the country. 160 cars were able to leave the city. It's been cut off from food, water, and heating systems,